History in every century records an act that lives forevermore. We'll recall, as into line we fall, the thing that happened on Hawaii shore. Let's remember Pearl Harbor as we go to meet the foe. Let's remember Pearl Harbor as we did the Alamo. We will always remember how they died for liberty. Let's remember Pearl Harbor and go on to victory.
He's presently a professor of history at William Patterson University. Holds a bachelor's degree from Fordham University, a master's degree from Columbia University, and a doctor of education from Columbia University. Dr. Kane is a graduate of the Officers Candidate School, United States Marine Corps, Quantico, Virginia, and holds the rank of Captain, U.S. Marine Corps Reserve. He's going to be showing us a series of slides, many of which have not seen public view very often, except one of his lectures about World War II. And I'm looking forward to seeing many of these slides for the first time. Please welcome James Kane.
He said all the smart ones in there.
Thank you, John.
Can you hear me in the back?
Absolutely.
Would that be all right if I spoke that way?
Perfect.
My friends, I'm very touched that you came out here on a soggy evening, so I'm not only flattered to be invited to be here, but I'm touched that you all came out. It's what Shakespeare called the questionable glory of a day in it. Remember when we were kids, we were taught that April showers bring May flowers? What do May flowers bring? May flowers bring pilgrims. Well, it's April in New Jersey. We're among bright and talented friends. We're in an elegant library, and we're talking American history. What could be better than that? So thank you, sir, for driving this train that talks about American history. I don't think we talk enough about it, actually. As John said, I've been very fortunate, except for the time I was in service, to spend most of my life in schools. And I think it's interesting, and you prove it to me tonight at least, the word student, it comes from a Latin word, studens. And studens had nothing to do with learning. Studens in the Latin meant to be eager. We would not be here tonight, not you, not me, not John, none of us, unless we're eager to be with nice people and maybe discuss Americanism. And interestingly, if anybody here has been in school, you know what I'm talking about. To me, it's a cruel joke. The word school comes from the Latin scola. Well, scola had nothing to do with learning either. Scola meant in the Latin leisure. So if you were around schools, you know that's a sick joke. The one thing in schools you don't have is leisure. The Romans were very practical people. They felt if you didn't have some leisure time and you weren't students eager, then you couldn't successfully study what they called the liberalis artis, the arts which liberate the mind. So we have some leisure time tonight. Can you still hear me back there? So we're all students tonight. Do we agree?
Yes. Okay.
What would be a back in school? I used to tell the story about the mom who could not get her son up for the first day of school. And he wouldn't get up. She said, "You've got to get up." He wouldn't get up. She said, "You've got to get up and go to school." He says, "I don't want to get up and go to school." She says, "Why don't you want to get up and go to school?" He says, "Because the kids don't like me and the teachers are mean to me." She says, that's still too bad. You've still got to get up and go to school. He says, why do I have to get up and go to school? She says, because you're 43 years old and you're the first. A little humor. Anyway, once again, thank you for having me. Thank you so much. Compared to the old countries in Europe, as we well know, and certainly compared to the ancient countries where you're traveling in the Orient, America is a very young country. But 238 years is a long time for a country founded just on principles and ideals. And tonight, in the time we have together, I've been asked to talk about 44 months of that American story, from December 7, 1941 until September 2, 1945. Some of it's going to be hurried because you go to Drew University and take that course in probably a semester. So to condense it here, we're going to do it pretty quickly. And I'm not going to possibly cover it all. But I think to start that story, we have to start with a guy named Yamamoto. I think his first name was Isokoro, which in the Japanese of the elegant society, it meant the age of the father when the child was born. So I think Isokoro meant 56, which is unusual, but in that culture is apparently pretty common. And he was adopted as a child. He was born in April, so he was an April baby. Speaking of April, by the way, that comes from a Latin word, aprilis, which means to blossom. So if we have any April babies in here, that rain out there, blossoming. He studies at Harvard, 19, somewhere in the early 20s, 20, 21, 22. And later on in his naval career, which was a distinguished career, he's assigned as a naval attaché in Washington, D.C., two different tours of duty. So he gets to know America pretty well. And not only that, he gets to speak English passively. And he travels the country to some degree. So he has a sense of America. And when his imperial command informs him in early 1941 that it wants him to draw up a plan to attack the American fleet at Pearl Harbor. By the way, if I don't think of it, the Polynesians of the 17th, 18th, and 19th century found in that body of water teeming with oysters that gave pearls. And the word was Pualama Kai. Pualama meaning pearl. That's where the word comes from, pearl. So Yamamoto's told to draw up these plans, these attack plans, and he resists them at some considerable risk. He resists them. But eventually he's overruled, and as a good military officer, he says, I accept my orders, and I will draw up the plans to attack the United States naval forces at Pearl Harbor. The reason he resisted them, because I said he had a sense of this country. But nonetheless, he draws up the plans, and he finds at the last minute, probably through espionage, that Pearl Harbor is a very shallow body of water. It's only 40 feet deep. Mm-hmm. Some of you have been to Pearl. You know, you can't tell looking at it, but it's a low body of water. So all of these torpedoes that he has made, he has to send back to a factory to be reconfigured with some wooden fins put on them. And the factory is in a city called Nagasaki. Mm-hmm. And what happened was the torpedoes he had, they needed 80 feet of water in which to operate, and they only had 40 feet, so they had to be reconfigured. Go back with me with Yamamoto. He left nothing unturned. Part of his attack plan is in October of 1941, he sends a Japanese cruise ship over the same route through the Northern Pacific and then down into the Central Pacific as he envisions his attack force will go. And I remember now, in those days, there was no shipping lanes in the Northern Pacific, no satellites up above, no jet planes. And he felt, common sense-wise, if that cruise ship could get down into the Central Pacific, without being discovered than his attack force could. And he did it. Think this with me, too, if you would. In fact, I played a record before some of you came in. I played a record by Glenn Miller, who, by the way, unfortunately, he didn't come back from the war. I'm told he was flying from England to France, a night flight across the channel, and his plane disappeared. I swim with guys who older were in England at the time, and they felt that probably some British aircraft coming back from German bombing or bombing runs over Germany, they're told to release their ordnance if they have any left before they land. And very likely, his plane was flying at a lower altitude, and somebody just got rid of that, blew him out of the sky. Because there was no May Day, he just disappeared. That was Glenn Miller playing that. The name of the song was Chattanooga Choo Choo. And I think that's interesting because that was the number one song in America on November the 29th, 1941, which happened to be Thanksgiving Day in America. And we're told that the people who sat down, and that was a different America. You remember when the two towns next to each other on Thanksgiving morning played a football game at 10 o'clock? Yeah. Remember that? Milburn probably played Taquanic. Yeah. You remember that? It was colorful and all the graduates came back and the flag squads were out and the cheerleaders. And it was just a nice American tradition. And that ended the football season, and that's over now. I think it's a pity. And then in the afternoon, remember we used to sweep the leaves out into the curb?
Yeah.
And we set them on fire? Yeah. Remember that haunting smell that told us we were in our hometowns? Remember that? Can't do that any longer. But that was a different America. And we're told when those folks sat down to Thanksgiving dinner that day, on that November 29th, they were thankful that we were not involved in that terrible war that was already raging in Europe. And apparently what we could not know at that very time, we were already under attack. Because on that Thanksgiving morning was when Yamamoto had his attack force loosen its lines way up in the northern, I think it's pronounced Kuril, K-U-R-I-L-E, the Kuril Islands, and head out at 12 knots radio silence out into the northern Pacific, actually towards the Aleutian Islands. And so while we were being thankful for not being involved in war, we were already under attack. It was, at the time, the largest naval attack force ever assembled. 33 ships of the line, a battleship, two cruisers, several destroyer escorts, six carriers, 350 planes on board them, with probably the world's finest naval aviators, or finest trained naval aviators at the time, six carriers. It had its own submarine squadron 200 miles ahead. It brought with it its own oilers, oil tankers, that once they got the final decision, they were about 5 days out in radio silence. The decision, the radio communication was climb Mount Nakita. And that was to say, things didn't go well in Washington with the negotiations that was going on. And then from 12 knots, they would make a 90-degree turn down into the Central Pacific at flank speed. And at 6:30 on the morning of December 7th, tropical sunny morning, and that was not an accident. Yamamoto knew Americans. 6:30. Remember, some of you probably served, there was a thing we had, it was called Cinderella Liberty. You had to be back by midnight, remember those days? So, at 6:30 that morning, his name was Nagumo. He was the admiral in charge of that attack force, and he brings his carriers into the wind 235 miles north of the coast of Kahuku, which is on the north shore of the island of Oahu in the Hawaiian chain. And at 6:30, he launches the first of two attacks. If you don't know Oahu, and I don't know if you're going to be able to see this or not, but and you'll see it up here in a moment. Anyway, Oahu is probably the most important island, both culturally and economically, as there is in the Hawaiian chain. It has two mountain ranges. One runs this way, and that's called the Kulau Range. And this one is called the Waianae's, the Waianae Range. And here's Nanakuli, if you know Oahu. And the attack force comes down on this side of the Waianae Mountain Range. And I've flown this. Actually, I flew this in a fighter aircraft. I wasn't a pilot, but I got airborne a couple of times with some of the fighter pilots. And once you cross the Waianae's down near Nanakuli, Pearl Harbor comes up under your left wing at 10 o'clock, almost immediately. His name was Fuchida, F-U-C-H. Can you still hear me in the back?
Yes.
F-U-C-H-I-D-A, Fuchida, Lieutenant Commander, very skilled naval aviator, and he led the first attack. There were two attacks. One left at 6:30 off those ships. The second one left about 8. It was on station at 9. Fuchida leads his attack force of 250 planes beyond those mountains, low, and as he comes across that Waianae Range, he breaks radio silence, and he radios back to the ships, Tora, 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 infamous day, Tora, 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 which meant Tiger, 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 we have achieved complete surprise. Now, on the ground, in places we know today as Iwa, maybe you know it as Barber's Point, Hickam Air Force Base, Bellows Air Force Base, Wheeler, do you remember From Here to Eternity? Do you remember Schofield Barracks? That was there. Kaneohe Bay, where I was, Marine Base across Kaneohe Bay. And there was a smaller base up on the North Shore called Haleiwa. But except for that, all of the others were attacked. All these attack planes didn't go at Pearl. Unfortunately, all of the aircraft we had at that morning, all the fighter aircraft that could have repelled these things, they were by order. They were lined up on their runways, wingtip to wingtip, so they could be better secured from sabotage or an attack from the sky. We lost over 200 planes there, and that's why most of them didn't get up into the sky. Anyway, Fuchida radios back. They make a 180, if you know Pearl, you'll see it in a moment. They can pass Pearl and make their turn. Interestingly, I mentioned the torpedoes and those pilots, how skilled they were. With the new configuration, the torpedo pilots, they had to be, pilots call it off the deck, they had to be 30 feet off the deck, off the water, to release those things so that they wouldn't hit the mud. And that gave them about 3 or 4 seconds to get airborne before they hit what they were going at. Now this, when we go out into the parking lot, if you look up at this building, it's probably 50 feet high, 40 feet high. So those planes were lower than this building. The first attack comes in about 10 minutes to 8 a.m., Sunday morning now, when Fuchida radios back, Tora, Tora, Tora. There are 1,177 very brave sailors and some Marines on board Arizona, and they had at the time about 16 minutes to live. And most of them died without knowing why they were dying because they were on below decks. Remember, Sunday morning in the military, unless you're on duty or unless you have chow assignments or unless you're going to church, you can sleep in or you don't have to get up. There's no duty assignments. So those guys, 1,177 of them went down with Arizona. And in fact, since then, another 21, I believe, when the last time I was out there was at 20, and I believe it went to 21. The United States Navy had decreed if you served aboard Arizona that morning and survived, if you wish to elect to spend your eternity back on that ship with your shipmates, you may have your ashes placed back on board. And 21 guys so far have. And it's not open to the public. It's a very solemn burial ceremony, and it's done after 5 p.m., after 1700, and no one watches except the family and the relatives. So it's a very moving story. Nonetheless, they are on station. They're looking, however, Fuchida is looking for 3 aircraft carriers. We have 3 aircraft carriers out in the Pacific. Enterprise, Saratoga, and the Lexington. But one is at Wake, delivering planes to Wake. One is at Midway, delivering planes to Midway. And one is on, I think the Saratoga is on its way back from Bremerton, Washington, having been refitted. So they weren't at Pearl. It's one of the big mistakes that happened that morning. And when Fuchida sees the carriers are not there, but there are all the battleships lined up, and I'm sure you know battleships were named for states in those days, Nevada, California, Oklahoma, Tennessee, West Virginia, Maryland, Pennsylvania, all the, even the Utah, but that was a World War I ship, that was on the other side of Fort Irwin. All there, so they became the target of the attack, these battleships. The first wave leaves about 10 minutes to 9, the second wave leaves at 10. The ships, the planes are recovered. The battle plan says at 1 p.m., 1,300 hours, that attack force is going to turn westward and sail for the harbor of Hiroshima for a victory celebration. And they recovered most of their planes, and off they went. And in their wake, they left chaos. They damaged badly the Pacific Fleet. They sunk six carriers.
Battleship.
Boy, this is a tough wig. They hit other ships too. The Raleigh was hit. There were 68 ships in the harbor at the time, but most of the damage was done on the battleships. Arizona was sunk in about 6 minutes. Apparently, a bomb came straight through the deck and down into the armament and just blew it in half, and it sunk in about 30 feet of water. And if you've been out there, you'll see a picture of it in a moment. You can still see it. And in fact, when I was privileged to have been out there, this was before the memorial, it was just a halt sitting there, and the United States Navy, God love it, every time a ship sailed past Arizona, going out of Pearl or coming back into Pearl, a command came over, anybody on deck, attention, hand salute, and everybody on deck saluted out and back. Very, very moving, very powerful. Reading it, however, those guys died quickly. They must have died instantly because the thing just blew up. The ones you really had to feel badly for were some of the guys who were on Oklahoma. Oklahoma was out, but some of the ships were tied up outboard of another ship. So the torpedoes were taking the hits at Pearl. For example, Maryland, Tennessee, I think, were inboard. So Oklahoma and West Virginia took the torpedoes. But Oklahoma doesn't sink, it capsizes. Now, it capsizes with guys below deck. And there's some air, so it didn't blow up. And there's some air pockets there. And some of these guys had access to water. And unfortunately, they started to mark up the hull, how long they had been there, day. And a couple of them lasted 12 days. Terrible to even think about. So as I say, they left chaos in the way. It was a tactical achievement for Yamamoto and for Fugamo, who was the leader of the attack force, and it was a serious strategic blunder. They made four or five colossal mistakes, the Japanese did. Number one, they didn't take out the submarine base, which was right there at Pearl. They didn't damage the shipyard capacity at Pearl. It was right below them. They didn't take out the oil tank farms. Even to this day, if you get out to Honolulu, as you come into Honolulu International, you see them. They're right down there. They're the same oil tank farms. They didn't take them out. They didn't go after the carriers. They didn't know where the carriers were, so they left anyway. In the battle attack plan of Yamamoto, he was so specific. He envisioned in the North Pacific, en route to the Hawaiian Islands, in the North Pacific, when the oilers are going to resupply the ships of the line, he envisioned several of the, they call them deckhands, being swept overboard, and right in the attack water, no one stops for them. And they lost 12 guys trying to resupply those big ships. The last mistake Yamamoto didn't make it because he knew it. But the last mistake the Royal Command of Japan made, they misread the American psyche. Remember, Yamamoto lived in America for several years. He knew America. And the Royal Command did not think Americans had the stomach for a war, nor did they have the stomach for a war across such a vast ocean as the Pacific. And I'm told, and I read, the very first thing people wanted to know was, in America, in their fear, where was Pearl Harbor? What the heck is Pearl Harbor? Remember, we're talking 1941. Most people probably who lived in Pequannock never went 20 miles away from Pequannock. Sure. I mean, that was that America. I grew up on old Staten Island. You know, a trip to Keynesburg was, wow. No, it's not like that, it's me. Two Dutch sailors during the colonial period rowing past, and one said to the other, "Is Staten Island?"
I don't think so.
Anyway, I read, and I'm told by some guys who served, that the feeling across America at the time, first it was fear, and then it became anger, and then it became rage, and then it morphed into revenge. And Yamamoto is reported as saying, when he was at the celebration, the victory celebration, which he did not participate in, he said, "I'm afraid we have awakened a sleeping giant, and we have filled it with a terrible resolve." And of course, that was his initial reservations. Let me show you some slides. Does this make sense? Does everybody see what we're doing here?
Yeah.
Like the hot dog said to the mustard, we're on a roll. You're looking at, this is Nevada. Nevada got underway. Huh. And I wasn't a Navy guy, but I sailed on Navy ships, and I know the sizes of the ones we were on. They were called APAs, transports, and the LSTs, much smaller. And I always wondered, how the heck did that thing get underway and an attack at the Southern at 7:55 on a Sunday morning? A couple of years ago, Maureen and I were traveling in the Balkans, and we're on a bus. We've been on these things. We're traveling with Grand Circle on a bus, and there's a guy sitting up ahead of us, and he's got a baseball hat on, and it says, "Pearl Harbor Survivor." Mm. Oh, I said, "He's got to give this guy a hug and say hello to him." So I did say hello to him when we stopped for a coffee break. And I said, "Geez, I love your hat, partner. Tell me about it." He says, "I was at Pearl that morning." I said, "What were you doing at Pearl?" He says, "I was on board Nevada." I said, "Wow." I said, "I have always wanted to ask somebody, how did that ship get underway when those attack planes came over? How long does it take to get a ship like that ready to get underway?" He said, "About 4 hours."
Yeah.
I said, "Why then?" He said, "The chief mate came back from Honolulu, remember Cinderella Liberty? And he had a few Mai Tais." And he gets back on board, and now it's midnight, and he says to the midnight crew, "Fire up the boilers. Let's see how quickly you can do it." And all night long, Nevada's boilers, and when those planes came overhead, it was ready to sail. Now, what happened, however, can you still hear me back there?
Yes.
What happened, however, it was sailing for the open sea, and if you know Pearl at all, it's a very narrow neck of the harbor, the entry, and the people on shore said, "Oh," because all the planes went after it. If that had been sunk in the harbor, it would have been disastrous. So they were told to beach it at a place called Hospital Point, and it just beached at Hospital Point, and that's where he came topside at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. Interestingly, that That ship, that size, when it hit that beach, made such a big indentation. Yeah. Today, it's a gorgeous tropical beach, and it's called Nevada Beach.
Yeah. Yeah. Fire on board there?
Yeah, that was hit by two torpedoes.
Yeah. Were they manning their anti-aircraft guns?
Yes, as many as they could. Very, very heroic. In fact, you're looking now at West Virginia. Remember, West Virginia was outboard. In fact, you can see men here. You can see men in the drink. And look at how heroic these guys are. They're not going away from the explosion. They're going right towards them. Huh. That was West Virginia. That's the Akagi. That's the flagship of Fugamo. Japanese flagship, that's called launch aircraft. That's what those flags are saying, launch aircraft. Those sailors, by the way, are called petty sailors, and the Japanese soldiers of World War II were called by the Japanese hierarchy penny soldiers because it only cost a penny postcard to recruit them. Remember, we had to go for physicals and examinations. They just send a postcard out and say, show up next Thursday. That's how they got those guys. Penny sword. That's Pearl, as Fujita would have seen it. Actually, I took this picture, but it's exactly as it was. This Aiea Heights. There are the Waianae Mountains I told you about. Come across the Waianae, and there's Pearl. This is called Fort Island. What you can see here, this white, that's the Arizona Memorial today. That's where Arizona was, and all the ships were along here. Over here were the sub base and those oil tanks I told you about, and look at the little space they had to go in there and knock that out. There's Pearl Harbor today. Pualama Kai is what the Polynesians refer to it as. Kai means water. I purposely took this the last time we were out there in December. I walked down to the beach and I took this purposely at 10 minutes to 8 on a Sunday morning. Oh, so there you can see what it looked like. And suddenly there are 350 planes overhead with there are four types, aerial bombers, torpedo bombers, fighters. And that's what it looks like at 10 minutes to 8 on a tropical morning. Yamamoto knew we'd be asleep. There's Oahu. I mentioned all of those different arrows are going to different airfields. So it wasn't only Pearl. They went to Hickam, Fellows, Powell. There's Arizona. Arizona, that was the third Arizona. There'll never be another one. That's Wheeler. Wheeler Air Force Base. The Waianae's behind it, but that's up near Fort Schofield Barracks, where the 25th Infantry was. There's Nevada again. This is on the windward side of Oahu. Very prominent. This is called Kaneohe Bay. Very scenic. If you saw the movie South Pacific, or you saw some of the other movies, a lot of it is filmed in here. Very beautiful, lush, tropical part of Oahu. This is on the windward side. That island is called Chinaman's Hat. The Japanese pilots were told, when you're headed for Kaneohe Bay, the Marine base, and also the Navy base out there, Kaneohe Bay, it's over here. All you had to do was come across here at about 105 degree azimuth, and it will take you right across into that bay. So that was a landmark called Chinaman's Hat for the Japanese pilots that morning. That's Hickam. Hickam Air Force Base. It's actually next to Honolulu International. And I think to the Air Force credit, they left the bullet holes and the shell markings in their major administration building. So when you see it, it's all Well, I've seen this in other places in the world. Very powerful. That's Shaw, a destroyer. And interestingly, I mentioned the Japanese did not go after the dry docks. That ship was refitted with a wooden hull, and 2 months later was sailing back to Bremerton for a new hull, and I'm sorry, a bow, and participated throughout the war. Mm-hmm. So by not taking out those yards, they made a huge, huge mistake. That's West Virginia and Tennessee. That's one of the smaller ships turned over. I mentioned that 2,400 American servicemen were killed that morning. Many of them, of course, died later, but also some civilians. This is Waipahu. I once knew machine guns pretty well. You can see all the hits here. That's not a 30 caliber. Trust me. That might be a 50 caliber, because those things are this long, big ones. And you can see where they were hit. There are four people in there, two in the front, two in the back, who didn't make it that morning. They were civilians. Mm. I'm the guy on the right. The guy on the left was that fellow I told you about who was aboard the water. So a lot of the things I'm telling you this evening, I'm sharing that he shared with me, who was there then. Well, sweet guy. I hope he's still healthy and well. There are those oil farms I told you about.
So why didn't they take them?
Nobody ever explained. Fukamo said his mission was to take out the Pacific Fleet, and so he concentrated on the fleet, the ships. So he didn't concentrate on the shipyards, on the sub base. On these. Fugamo, by the way, was demoted after the Battle of Midway, which was 6 months after this, and four of his six carriers were sunk at Midway, and he was relieved of command and sent to command the troops on the island of Saipan. Mm. And eventually the Marine Corps went ashore there and killed all of them, and he suicided at Saipan. That's a two-man sub. There was one dead body in there, and one was captured. That's off the beach at a place called Lanakai. If you know the island, Lanakai is a beautiful beach. In fact, Lanakai in the Polynesian means heavenly water. This is the aircraft that strafed and killed a lot of sailors and Marines at the Kaneohe Marine Base. And was shot down by aircraft. And when I went back, I was at that base for a long time. When I went back for a visit, I saw a monument. It was not there after the war, trust me. I saw a monument in honor, in tribute of this pilot. And I said, I had a guy with me. I said, what is this? He said, well, that's the pilot shot down here. I said, yeah, but he killed a lot of people in this space. Apparently, now I'm going to be very objective. I'm not editorializing. The parents of that pilot wrote years later to President Carter and asked if they could place a memorial to their son on board that base, and he said yes. I'm not editorializing. I'm just being objective. All of those were destroyed. Those are the Catalinas, they're called. That's Nevada finally getting underway a year later. Three carriers. This was interesting. This is on the island of Kauai, not far from the forbidden island of Niihau, and the Japanese placed a submarine just offshore there, and if any of the Japanese planes were in trouble, they were instructed to land right there, and the Japanese would pick them up. There's Oklahoma. Remember I told you it capsized? Those guys were living under that pole. This is that's a kamikaze attack later on the Hornet. I think Somebody help me out. I think the Hornet launched the Doolittle raid.
Yes.
Am I right there?
Yes.
Yes. And that's later on a kamikaze attack. So, what happened after the attack? We are told eventually, see if I get this right, 13 million Americans served. America had a home front. There was a front in the Pacific, a front later in Europe, had never been tried before on a global scale, and a front at home. And everybody apparently came together, and there's a look at an early enlistment station. The draft cranked up.
You may want to point out that it was 10% of the population of the United States in 1940.
Sorry?
It was 130 million people in the population.
Yes, yes. Did everybody hear that? We had a much smaller population in those days, and that was about 10%. But the important thing was that people also pitched in here. A lot of women went into factories where they had not been before. There was a women's group, over 100,000 women served, but there was a WAST, Women's Air Service Transport. These were women who either knew how to fly or were taught how to fly, and they flew across it's called CONUS, Continental United States. They flew wounded to hospitals. They took new planes just built and flew them to where they were supposed to be. They did supply runs across the country, and the idea was to allow men to get out to Europe and to the Pacific to fly the combat missions. And to, I think, the discredit of this country, they were never recognized until the 1970s. Never recognized until the 1970s. And 38 of them were killed in either training or in...
Are they the ones in the upper? Those the pilots?
I would say that they're not even in that shot. That's just a shot. That was America in those days.
There's still some women in that group meeting once a month.
Yes. Excellent. This is the old, it still looks just like this. This is the old Confederate train station at a place called Quantico, Virginia. This is right after Pearl. These guys have passed, most of them are college men. They've passed tests, they've passed some physicals, and they've been sent to Quantico, where in the Marines, that's where the Officer Candidate School is. One among them, I'm told, was a guy named Power, Ty Power, who was also a pilot. Years later, a couple years later, very distinguished career flying multi-engine craft over the Solomons, and we knew him later on as Tyrone Power. He was a very well known. I know this station pretty well because years later, I was one of these guys, and the guy next to me, I knew I was in a different place. The fella next to me raised his hand to ask the DI a question. He said, "Put your hands down. If you have any questions, I'll give them to you." Now why do I show this? That's the home of the old Brooklyn Dodgers. That's Ebbets Field. Maybe some of you remember. In fact, when Levine jumped with the 82nd Airborne at Normandy, the first station was a guy named Gil Hodges. Fought with the 1st Marine Division on Okinawa, an infantry platoon sergeant. Robinson, stateside, Reese at Guam. Billy Cox, the third baseman, came back with demons in his head. Too many German mortar rounds near him. Snyder served, Perullo served. But I put this up here because as soon as it happened, Major League Baseball wrote to President Roosevelt and said, "Would you like us to stop baseball for the duration?" And he said, "No, baseball is so much important to the American psyche. Get it on in any way you can." And so that's why I put that up there. I have no idea where that is. I didn't take it. But I think it's probably a scene played out. Some of us here maybe remember it well. Played out across this. And when I look at that, I often wonder what happened to those two. Yeah. There was a band leader named Sammy Kay. Anybody remember that? Band leader named Sammy Kay, and he had a singer. And they wrote a song that apparently, I remember, I'm old enough to remember the end of it, but I'm told it became like a second anthem. It was played at graduations, it was played at reunions, it was played at football games, and played on radio.
History, in every century, records an act that lives forevermore. We'll recall, as into line we fall, the thing that happened on Hawaii shore. Let's remember Pearl Harbor as we go to meet the foe. Let's remember Pearl Harbor as we hit the Alamo. We will always remember how they died for liberty. Let's remember Pearl Harbor and go on to victory.
Anybody remember that?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
I think this is America at its very best. I don't know of an America better, and I've been proud to live in this country as you have been. This is North Platte, Nebraska. If you're interested in reading about it, that's the name of the book, Once Upon a Town. North Platte was a tank town. Sometimes that's not a very attractive appellation, but a tank town is where, along the Union Pacific, where a train would stop to get water and they would be there 30, 35 minutes, not like a quick stop. North Platte, 12,000 people in all of the surrounding ranches and farms and towns, they knew when the trains were coming through. From 1941, after President Roosevelt talked to or addressed our Congress and he said a date which will live in infamy, the people of North Platte, on their own, remember they were under rationing too, they met every troop train going east and going west, and they brought cookies, cakes, Milky Ways, newspapers, and finally, the Union Pacific gave them the whole terminal. They put banjos in there, they put pianos in there, and it was dancing. So for 25 minutes, these guys could get off that train and find a little bit of America welcoming them and just giving them a big hug. And later on, after the 1944, when the wounded were coming back and they couldn't get off the train, these people got on the train to make sure they were welcome back. North Platte, Nebraska, I think that's it's a story that it's just America at its very best. This is the home front. We collected tin foil. Oh, there's the Royal Hawaiian. That's the Navy took this beautiful hotel over, and an enlisted man could stay there for the night for 50 cents and an officer for $1.10. And tonight, this night, you would pay $600 for a room that, not so good. Now we start back. After the Doolittle raid comes Guadalcanal in the Solomons. Those are members of the 1st Marine Division. The Japanese Army later said the Japanese Army was buried on Guadalcanal. These are the guys who did it. That was Arizona for a lot of months after. This is 1944, because until then, the German submarines were just off Coney Island and just off Staten Island, and we wouldn't send those troop ships out. But once we had probably settled the German submarine boat, then the big troop ships went out. Those guys are probably going to France. There is Normandy, called Bloody Omaha. Probably the saddest day in American history, of the United States Army. There are five beaches along there. I didn't know until I got to see them, 55 miles long. But the two right flank beaches, Utah and Omaha, this was Omaha. Utah was defended by conscripts prisoners of war, kids who were too young to fight, people who were too old to fight on the Eastern Front. Utah was a fairly easy beach to get in. The 4th Infantry Division went ashore there, had casualties, but only 100 and some out of a whole division. Not Bloody Omaha. Bloody Omaha was defended by the 352nd Infantry Division that had been rotated back from the Eastern Front. So these poor guys came ashore, and plus it was a saucer-like beach. Plenty of emplacements down there they had to get through. The Navy released the tanks too far out, and they all went under, and most 29 out of 32 went under. They were about a half mile out. That's too far. You know, those things aren't built to the amphibians. I think 2,500 American soldiers were killed that morning on the landing at D-Day. And it was so important because that's not even the invasion of Europe. That was just to get a foothold in Normandy so the invasion could start to get more troops tomorrow and the next day and the next month ashore. Right? So these guys, I talked to one of them. I said, what was it like when that ramp went down? He said, it was like stepping into hell. Machine guns, they had 22 machine gun placements up here, and these guys had no cover, no protection. And I can tell you this, a 30 caliber machine gun crew has a gunner, an assistant gunner, and an ammo carrier. And the gunner carries the gun, of course, the assistant gunner, the tripod, and the ammo carrier carries not only a can of bullets, he also carries a pair of asbestos gloves. And every fifth round is a tracer. And you can have, that's called a tracer for a reason. You can see the strike of your bullet. If that thing starts, the red bullet goes, you know the barrel is burned out. They use the asbestos gloves. In less than 2 minutes, they have a new barrel on that 30 caliber. So these guys had about four hours of, you can't imagine how heroic they were. And it was a very, very bad day. But they got ashore.
Why did they let them out?
They let the amphibious tanks out too far at sea.
Yeah, why?
Nobody ever explained it. They were supposed to be within 600 yards of it. It just happened. Not good.
Yeah, but it was also there, the terrain, you had that high.
Oh, yeah, the bluff above. The bluff above. Oh, absolutely. Oh, yeah. Absolutely. Now, this was at Utah Beach. As soon as some of the guys I talked to, as soon as they got ashore, a lot of those defenders I was telling you about, the conscripts, the people from Ukraine, the prisoners of war, they didn't want to fight for the Nazis, Germany. So as soon as the 4th Infantry Division got ashore, that's what they found. In fact, one guy said, the first thing he heard was, when was lunch? I'm at one of the beaches. They had there's still equipment there. That's called the Mulberry Landing Dock behind me. It'll be there forever. There's the 4th Infantry Division. Now they've liberated Paris. That's off Saipan in the Pacific. That's I mentioned an APA, a Navy transport. This is Pearl, and that's a Marine Infantry Battalion going aboard. Somebody mentioned bandoliers here, and reminded me that the expression, these bandoliers came in feet. So with the machine gun, the bandolier would be 9 feet long. I think the guys who flew over Europe in the B-25s or the 29s, those bandoliers were 27 feet long, so they were 9 yards. So when you hear the expression, he got all 9 yards, that's where it came from. Interestingly, now, that's the bridge over the River Kwai. I visited that a couple of years ago, and I was surprised to see what's actually there. Iwo Jima, probably the bloodiest battle in the Pacific in World War II. That's called Suribachi, it's 55 stories high. February 1945, it's the only battle in the Second World War where there were more casualties on the winner's side than on the loser's side. There were 22,000 Japanese, and they're all dug in. I talked to guys who were on Iwo. And by the way, it lasted 36 days. Nobody was there for 36 days. They talk in terms of how long they were ashore. One guy might say, I was ashore for 11 days. I made it 14 days before they were beat up or taken out. So anyway, this was probably the bloodiest battle. Think Manhattan from around the Empire State Building down to the Battery. That's the size of Iwo. 22,000 people. 6,800 Marines killed. A lot more hurt or wounded. In fact, the Marine general said, victory was never in doubt. What was in doubt, would we have any Marines left to bury our dead? And that's the famous... I think I've got something here. Watch. I'm personalizing this. I'm putting this up here because of that. That's an extinct volcano. This is on a place called Pahakaloa. It's called Camp Tarawa. I'm the guy in the picture. Does that look like me?
Yeah.
I think that's the last cigarette I smoked. Remember our sea rations? We used to get little packets of old gold, those little four. That's probably the last one I smoked. Anyway, I put this because the guys in the picture following me, they trained on that ridge for that volcano I showed you. I can show you in a minute. It's the arguably the most famous photograph ever taken. And there it is. This is on day four. By the way, that was the second flag race. It was a small one race. Nobody could see it well, and they wanted a big one up. Texas, Wisconsin. By the way, he was a Navy corpsman. Five infantrymen and a Navy. And it's pronounced corpsman. Not corpsman.
It's funny what the president
said. Corpsman. Wisconsin, Kentucky up in the hills. Pima Indian, Ira Hayes from Arizona. On the backside, Pennsylvania, and in here, a young guy from, very handsome guy. His name was René Gagnon, a French-Canadian from New Hampshire. And the guy said they always wanted to go on Liberty with him because he was so handsome he attracted all the girls. Notice, this is a Japanese drainage pipe. Hmm. That's why it's so long, why you needed six of them to get it up. They're still Japanese, so here throw grenades at them. Quick story. When this, by the way, the only one to live out a normal life was the corpsman. He lived, he got back, bad wound to his leg, but he lived and he became an undertaker and lived 73 years, the only one.
He's the only one who had medicine.
This, he was dead within 11 days of this shot. He was the first one dead, the kid from Kentucky. He said, "I feel fine, they didn't hurt me," and that was his last words. His last words were, "They killed me." And the one on the other side, the squad leader, he was dead. I think a mortar round got him. He just disappeared. But this is day four of the battle. Everybody now, it gets back to America. They want to know who these people are. And the Navy misidentifies him as a guy from Boston. His mother down in the Rio Grande of Texas, when they see the picture, she said, "There's Holland." But you can't tell Holland. You can't see their faces. She said, "That's my son. That's Holland." But the Navy misidentifies him, and everybody tells Mother, "All right, it wasn't all of him. Relax." 1946, it's over. Three of them are dead. He's back on his reservation. He hitchhikes across Arizona, across New Mexico, into Texas, hitchhikes down into the Rio Grande to his little village, and he asked the postman, "Where can I find his parents?" And they sent him down a little dirt road, and there's a guy out there farming, and he walks up behind him, and he says, "Were you Holland's father?" I said, "Yeah, I was Holland's father." He said, "That was Holland at the base of the pipe."
Wow.
Big investigation, turns out. Sure enough, turns out that was Holland, not the kid from Boston who was also killed. The mother says, "I put enough talcum powder on that kid's rear end to know my Holland when I see it." That's where the Potsdam Conference was held. I was there in June, and that's where the three great powers had unconditional surrender. There it is. That's Times Square. That's the signing, MacArthur, Halsey, Nimitz.
Is that Wainwright sitting there?
I think Wainwright is in the back, or maybe he's over there, but he was there, certainly. Yeah. Interestingly, Missouri wasn't built, wasn't commissioned until 1944. It was built over here in the Brooklyn Navy Yard. President Roosevelt fully intended to send the USS New Jersey, which had a far more distinguished record in the Second World War and in the Pacific, for the honor of having the surrender taken on board in Tokyo Bay. I'm old enough to remember, April 12th, 1945, President Roosevelt, gone. And we didn't know our vice president too well. We didn't have 24-hour news today. Right? We didn't know him too well. New vice president. President Truman. Where's Truman from?
Missouri. The show me. Yeah,
that's why the Missouri was used. Should have been the New Jersey. Truman comes along. He's from Missouri. I don't blame him. He sent his own ship. Even at that level. I mentioned to John when we had dinner earlier. The war ends in 1945. But the war doesn't end for a lot of Americans, including guys like this. Mm. This is Holleran Hospital on Staten Island. Maybe you've heard of it. Very prominent military hospital for these guys. And by that time, I was old and I was a ball player, and they had a beautiful ball field there. And I played third base, so these guys would come down and they'd be sitting right where you are, where I'm playing. And what a beautiful group of guys. And I used to think, it's like, God, I hope the world is good to them. But this was, say, 19... maybe 4 or 5 years after the war was over, they're still being treated. Mm-hmm. Powerful, powerful stuff. Beautiful men. Beautiful men. We're about over here, my friends. Oh, this, now we're back to the beaches at Normandy. There's the cemetery. 9,600 crosses and stars of David. 33 sets of brothers and one father sunset. When we got there that morning, we were the first group there, and I guess we were 45 or so on the bus, and the administrator came out with two French women. And by the way, the only time there's a word written on the American flag is when the French put flags down of appreciation, and on each flag it says merci. And this is now American soil. Anyway, he said, did any of you guys serve? And a couple of us did, so they gave us the honor of raising the flag, and I'm the guy here, and it was very powerful. Each grave marker faces to the west, towards America. Mm-hmm.
Powerful.
Now you're looking at Arizona and the memorial. Notice the symbolism in the architecture. In the beginning, we were down. But on both the Pacific front and the European front, we came back up and were victorious. And so that's the symbolism.
Most people, they don't think, understand that that sits crosswise on the Arizona.
Yes, yes. Thank you, yes. Sir. Everybody hear that? No. When you walk out on that, Arizona is in 8 feet of water. In fact, some of the gun turrets are still above water, and it's going this way and that way. So this is kind of above it, and you're looking right down at the ship. Yeah. Powerful, powerful visit. That's the cemetery in the Pacific. It's in a place, it's in an extinct volcano called Punch Bowl. Remember a man named Ernie Pyle?
Yeah.
He's buried there, and no one knows who did it, but every Monday morning someone comes and puts a Hawaiian lei on his grave. Mm-hmm. There's Missouri now. Missouri is tied up 70 yards from Arizona. Arizona's right. See the color of the water here?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's oil coming up from Arizona. Each day, oil comes up from the ship. It's called the Black Tears of Pearl.
And there's Arizona's right there, and there's Missouri. Arlington. Tomb of the Unknowns. I think 3rd Infantry Division. I love these guys. When the United States Congress says, there's a blizzard coming, or Hurricane Sandy's coming, we're going to shut down the government, everybody go home, these guys don't go home. They walk their post regardless of the weather. If you notice, he's not wearing any insignia, any rank. The expression is he's a slick sleeve private, because it can't be shown that he might outrank the unknowns. So that's why he wears no rank insignia. He has the rifle to the outboard side of the tomb, always to the outboard side. He will stand there for 21 seconds. He will then march 21 paces. He'll stop. He'll wait 21 seconds. The rifle will be placed, turn around, the rifle will be placed again on the outboard. Wait 21, march, everything's in 21, because the 21 gun salute is the highest honor we can give anybody in this country. And it's driven by 21. And that's, I took that over Pearl. Interesting, we're about finished. If you lived, or if you remembered New York and the blackout in 1942, 43, because they were the German subs were only 5 miles offshore, and they were silhouetted, the ships were being silhouetted. This was blacked out too, so she was dark just like everyone else, except for the night of the landings at Normandy. And her light came back on, and all through the night it blinked, dot, 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 which was victory, V for victory, all night long, and then the light went back out until the war was over. My friends, that kind of brings us to the end of those 44 months. It started with Yamamoto. Yamamoto, by the way, interestingly, God love the American, the Army Air Force. It wasn't the Air Force in those days. It was the Army Air Force. We had broken the Japanese code. So we knew, and Roosevelt wanted him dead. He wanted Yamamoto, personal. And we had broken that code, and we knew that Yamamoto, remember I said we start with Yamamoto, was going on an inspection tour of the Northern Solomon Islands, one of which is called the Island of Bougainville. And we knew exactly when his two planes were supposed to land there. And the Army Air Corps, before my time, were flying P-51s, which could go a long way.
P-38s.
P-38s. All right. P-38s. Thank you, sir. Everybody hear that? I thought there were 51s. Nonetheless, they timed a brilliant maneuver. They timed to be on station when Yamamoto's plane was coming down, and they shot him out of his plane out of the sky, and they shot him directly. He was killed with one of those 50 calibers under his jaw. And we couldn't take credit for it, because by taking credit for it, we would have had to acknowledge that we had their code. But it wasn't well after the war that happened. I didn't mention England too much here. A lot of the guys were in England, I'm told, and it was said over there that the English soldiers said of the American guys over here, there were three things wrong with them. They were overpaid, they were oversexed, and they were over here. But I'll leave you quickly with something from England. Shakespeare is born on April the 23rd, 1564. He dies on April the 23rd, 1616. The people in his village where he died, they said he was celebrating his birthday too much in the pubs. Also dead on that day was Cervantes in Spain. Remember Men of La Mancha? That's Cervantes. Cervantes writes in one of his essays, and as I was here with you for the last hour or so, being very appreciative of how you treated me, he writes, great men and great women are capable of great kindness. And you've been very kind to me, so I thank you. Did you ever hear the question? Was it pure luck or serendipity that the carriers went out of Pearl? Well, we knew that there were Marines on Wake that had to be reinforced. We knew that Midway, which was only 900 miles north, had to be reinforced. And I don't know what the cycle of repair of those ships, so I can't answer the question. I think whoever knew probably took it to his grave with him. But it's good they were gone.
Yes, it was.
let me just elaborate on that point. All of the battleships, except the Arizona, were fitted and served in the Second World War.
Oh, yeah.
They were obsolete.
No, not Oklahoma. Oh, I'm sorry.
The Arizona was the one that still was. They were obsolete. All battleships have been determined to be obsolete.
Yes, yes. But yet some of them, in fact, West Virginia was in Tokyo Bay that morning, and some of them were at Okinawa, some of them were at Normandy, so they did come back. But Arizona, no, and certainly not Oklahoma. In fact, Oklahoma was sold for scrap, and I think it's sunk. Sir?
I have a question, and you're free not to answer.
this is a tough wig.
Would you repeat the question?
He said he had a question, but I am free not to answer it if I don't care to.
You mentioned that they held the attack force under Yamamoto's instruction. They're coming down from the north on the radio side.
Yes.
And that a certain signal was going to be given to them.
Yes.
To signal that the negotiations in Washington had broken down.
Yes.
Do you know what the negotiations
were? Well, I knew there were diplomats in Washington, but are you talking about the signal itself?
No. What were the negotiations?
I can't answer that. It might have been about oil, might have been about embargo, the embargo that was there.
Yeah.
Yamamoto was upset because the attack happened before the negotiations were announced that they were falling apart. That's why the surprise attack came. The signal sent from Japan was flying out of the Kido, I think.
You didn't mention that the Army-Navy game was the next Saturday right before, on December 6th.
Oh, I didn't know that. Yes. Everybody hear that?
Yeah.
The Army-Navy game was the day before.
Yeah, in Philadelphia.
Yes.
And, I mean, apparently there was a lot of drinking after that.
I didn't know that.
And the general there in charge at Hawaii, the admiral, weren't on speaking terms.
What were their names? Kimball and Short?
Yes.
Yes, yeah. And I think they were scapegoated. I think they were demoted or
retired. How many planes did they
have? The Japanese, I read, had 350. Mm-hmm. And
how many did the U.S. take out, though?
How many did we down? I think about 325 or 30 got back to the carriers.
Yeah.
So about that much.
Yeah.
Jim, I want another question?
Yes, sir.
Is it true?
You don't have to answer. That was a good question, huh?
That we had primitive radar.
Yes, of course.
And private woke up the lieutenant.
Everybody hearing this?
There was a squadron that was coming from west to east, and got up to the major, and then said, "No, it's just the American squadron taking a circuitous route to see the beautiful sunrise on Hawaii Sunday morning."
B-17.
A question in the back. There was a very primitive radar set up in the Red Hills of Kahuku. Okay. And that's where these planes flew over. At the same time, there was an evening flight coming from California, I think B-17s, a squadron of them.
Yeah.
And the people, wherever that was down in, I'm not sure even where they would be. Anyway, Honolulu side,
they got a call from the 7 a.m. from the two guys who wanted to go out for breakfast saying, we've got a whole lot of blips on this screen. When they wired it in to, God, I wish I remember. Anyway, on the Honolulu side, the officer finally said, don't worry about it. Those, and they were reporting the Japanese main attack force. Mm-hmm. They were saying, those are our B-17s coming in from California. And interestingly, thank you, sir, they flew right into the attack. And so the squadron leader said, find your way down. We're in war. And some of them went into Hickam. Some went into Bellows. The Air Force was very small. Very small runway. How they ever got down, I don't know. And some went into Wheeler. And some didn't come in. A couple of them got knocked
out. One more question, if I have.
The two bombs were dropped, Nagasaki and Hiroshima.
Yes.
The first one was Little Boy. And that was from the Enola Gay.
Yes.
That was
everybody hearing this?
And that was a uranium. Mm-hmm. The second one was a plutonium.
Yes.
On Brock's boxcar.
Yes.
And that was dropped with a parachute. And that was a plutonium. And that bomb was named Batman.
Right.
After Winston Churchill.
Yes. Well, I know that the names are correct. I don't know if it was after Churchill. I know the Enola Gay was named for Tibbetts's mother.
Right.
The pilot. But that's very true.
That's very true.
And in fact, I don't think Nagasaki was the intended target. And I think somewhere in Japan, there's some, they call it luck, because the target they were going after, they didn't go, and it was their luck that they didn't go and they went. But it wasn't an interesting, at the very beginning, both Hiroshima and Nagasaki are in the conversation, and they're in at the very end.
Anything else? One last point.
Yeah, World War II was the last declared war for the United States.
Everybody hear that?
Thanks, Jim.
Thank you so much.